I'm Dhruva Juloori from Uber's developer platform. My work primarily focuses on handling continuous integration of changes at scale, especially with environments with high commit velocity. So today I'm here to share insights about like how do we handle merging at Uber all while maintaining green mainlines. So I want to start with first principles. Why is green mainline a hard problem? So what you see is a representation of a mainline with certain commit points being green, which means that all the necessary checks the developer cares are passing, test cases, et cetera, compilation, et cetera. Now, the two developers, Alice and Bob, basically create their branches from a same reference point and introduce their changes respectively. Alice introduces C1 and Bob introduces C2. Now, both of them test their changes. All the CI checks pass. Pretty good. Alice goes ahead and merges his change into the mainline. The mainline is still green. Pretty good. But when Bob merges, the build steps fail on the mainline. Because both of the developers have tested their changes individually, but not collectively together. Now, just imagine at scale when hundreds of developers are concurrently committing to a single code base or a single branch. So at Uber scale, we have about 4,500 plus engineers working from 10 plus global development centers, concurrently committing to 6 of our monorepos primarily, Go being the largest, and then followed by mobiles, and then Java, web, and Python. So our monorepos handle a scale about 65,000 plus changes per month, and are home to 1,000 plus business critical microservices, and they facilitate about 100,000 plus deployments per month, and hosts about 135 million lines of code, or even more than that as we speak. What are the drawbacks of red mainline? First one, delayed rollouts. So if you're the most stable branch is red, meaning that the build steps are failing, you would not be able to release patches or enhancements or fixes, which could impact the business directly in terms of cost. Hampered productivity. When hundreds of developers are concurrently committing to a single repo, developers might not be sure like why their changes are failing in CI, which leads to an hampered productivity. And as I said, at scale, when numerous people are cooperating and trying to merge to a single code base, it gets very hard to roll back to the last known stable state. So no company or a business wants to be in this state because it directly impacts a company in terms of cost, time, and resources. How do we solve it? Yeah, welcome to SubmitQueue. This is what I work on. It's essentially a merge queue of Uber. It provides an illusion of single queue to all the Uber developers to submit their changes. It guarantees reasonable SLOs for developers to land their changes quickly. It utilizes CI resources very efficiently. And of course, it always and always guarantees green mainlines at scale, even with thousands of changes per day or hundreds of changes per hour. So next question is, how do we do this? Okay, before going in detail, I would like to give a short summary or a high-level overview about the system. In a nutshell, SubmitQueue broadly consists of four core components. The first one being the enumerator. It basically takes the queue of pending changes and builds a binary decision tree of all the possible builds for those changes, which we internally call it as a speculation tree. It's just a decision tree. And then the profiler takes the speculation tree as an input and basically ranks the changes according to the landing order by predicting the build times. Then the prioritizer, it computes the probability of build needed for each node in the speculation tree. And then selector, basically it selects the top probability nodes and schedules those nodes as build in CI. And based on the build outcomes, it either commits or rejects a change. Now let's just take a working example. Let's say there are three changes arrived in the order mentioned, C1, C2, and C3. For C1, there's only one possible build. So you just need to test the change C1 against the head of the mainline. So we denote this build as B1, which represents the build steps for head of the mainline and the change C1. For the change C2, since it has arrived after C1, there are two possible builds. Meaning like C2 needs to be tested in the cases when C1 is successful and also in the cases when C1 is a failure. In a similar fashion, for C3, we have four possible builds. Now, this doesn't scale. I wish we had infinite resource capacity, but world is not ideal. So for n changes, you would essentially, the possibilities are like 2 power n minus 1 because these are like perfect binary trees. So we need to be more smarter way on how do we select the bills or how do we prioritize them. So first, we introduce a concept of conflict analysis. So far, we have built speculation trees under the assumptions that all of the changes conflict with each other. But if we can prove that changes don't conflict with each other, we can reduce the number of possible bills, which means that reducing the speculation pace, and also we can commit changes in parallel. But how do we determine the changes are independent or conflicting? Well, we leverage build system, like Buck or Bayesian. So the intuition behind conflict analysis is two changes are said to be independent if they affect a disjoint set of build targets, meaning if they affect a same set of targets, they're conflicting, otherwise they're not. As simple as that. So let's take a couple of examples. In this case, C2 and C3 are independent changes. They are conflicting with C1. So here, the total possible bills are 4, but in the previously, 5, but previously they were 7. So we reduced it by a factor of 2. So just imagine at scale. And C2 and C3 can be committed in parallel too. In this case, C1 and C2 are not conflicting, but C3 conflicts with both of them. So C3 has to wait until the decisions of C1 and C2 are determined. So the total possible builds are 6, but C1 and C2 can be committed in parallel. But yeah, this is well and good. But what if, as I said, world is not ideal. Conflicts can exist, but how do we deal if there are actual real conflicts? So here comes the concept of probabilistic speculation, where we compute the probability of build needed for each node in the speculation tree by predicting the chain success. So as I said, for C1, there's only one possible build. So the probability that you would need that build to make a decision on C1 is 100%, so because there's only one. But in the case of B2, you would only need, in the case of C2, you would only need the build B12 if the B1 is successful. The B1 success is completely dependent on the change C1. And conversely, you would need the build B2 if the B1 is failure, because basically, if chain C1 fails. In a similar fashion, you could compute the probabilities of all the nodes, which seems fine, but there's still a challenge. For example, if we take this case as an example, there are two changes and the total possible bills are 3. C2 has 2 possible bills and C1 has 1. So here, the build B1 is still in progress. C1 has only 1 possible build. But while the build B1 is still in progress, all the builds of C2 have been evaluated and yield the same outcome. Probably C1 is a very large diff and C2 could be a very trivial diff or probably changing a very small set of targets in a repository. So in this case, the chain C2 can only be landed after C1 is evaluated, meaning after the build B1 is finished. Yeah, similar example. In this case, the builds of C1 and C2 are in progress, while all the builds of C3 have been finished. So C3 cannot be landed until all of the builds of C1 and C2 are evaluated. So this leads to a very detrimental effect at scale, especially during the peak hours, because the longer the change waits in the queue, the chances of it conflicting with the future incoming changes increases, which means that as the conflict rate increases, the number of possible builds increases. So we don't want that. So whenever we can determine a change is safe to land, we should be in a position to go ahead and just land. So we introduce a concept of bypassing large diff, which essentially means if all the speculative builds of the change with its conflicting changes ahead are evaluated and yield the same outcome, then this change can bypass all of the conflicting changes ahead and land it. So if you take a previous example, in this case, all of the builds of the chain C3 have been evaluated while C1 and C2 are in progress. Since all of the builds are being evaluated and have the same outcome, we can just bypass C1, C2 and land C3 because the order of landing doesn't really matter. As the state of mainline, when C3 landed first and then C1, C2 next, would be equivalent to the state of mainline when C1, C2 is landed first and C3 next. It's all commutative. A plus B equal to B plus A, or A into B equal to B into A. Now, taking all of these factors into consideration, we want to prioritize our builds in such a way that we want to prioritize all of the speculative builds for the changes it can bypass, meaning that if a change can bypass, it's all the conflicting changes ahead. We want to prioritize all of its builds so that the changes can be landed faster. In the cases where a change cannot bypass its conflicting changes ahead, you would only want to prioritize the most likely nodes, most likely builds, so that you can optimize resources. Now, taking these two assumptions and putting into a mathematical notation, we derive the following formula. Basically, the probability of build needed depends on build outcomes on the conflicting changes ahead and the ability of the respective change to bypass its conflicting changes ahead. So the next question is, how do we evaluate build outcomes and the finish times? Well, we use machine learning. We train machine learning models for all our repos. So each repo has two models, a regression and classification. Regression model to predict the build times and classification model to predict the change success. We have a prediction accuracy of 97% for our classification models, and mean absolute percentage error for our build time prediction is about 5 to 7%, roughly. Some of our prominent features for our machine learning model are change characteristics, number of affected targets, removed targets, number of added lines, removed lines, and status of pre-submit checks, etc. And also some of the dynamic characteristics like speculation, like where, depends on the position of node in the tree, how big is the tree, and the width of the tree, things like that. So summing up everything, it's basically the architecture of SubmitQueue. As I said, there are four core components. The enumerator takes all the pending changes and build does the conflict analysis using the target analyzer and builds the speculation trees. And then profiler takes the trees as an input and ranks the changes according to the landing order by predicting the build times using the build time analyzer. And then the prioritizer, it computes the probability of build needed for each node using the land ranking information given by the profiler and also by predicting the chain success using the success predictor. And then the selector, this is easy. It basically selects the top probability nodes as builds in the CI. And based on the build outcome, it either commits or rejects the change. So yeah, SubmitQueue has been at Uber for a while, since the tail end of 2017. And after our recent announcements of introducing bypassing large diff and build time prediction, we have achieved a significant drop in resources, meaning we are building less while maintaining same or equal, same or even more number of changes. Like we observed in our major monorepos, like a 53% drop in the CI resources that we use. Since we are building less, so our CPU consumption reduced by 45%, and our P95 waiting times have been reduced by 37%, meaning we are able to land changes 37% faster than before, what we used to. Well, these are some of the resources that we have published publicly. Keeping Master Green at Scale is our first paper, which we published at EROSIS 2019. Bypassing Large Diffs in SubmitQueue is an Uber Engineering blog. CI at Scale, Lean, Green, and Fast is a paper that we published recently and got it accepted in ICSC 2025. And again, Slashing CI Costs at Uber is an Uber Engineering blog. Feel free to check out them. Yeah, that's about it. Anyone would like to discuss about handling continuous integration of changes at scale or merging strategies, would be open to discuss. And yeah, now open to any questions.